All right. Good evening, everybody. So today there was a little bit of a glitch and we've got a couple of seconds late, but a very happy welcome back on the Thursday webinar. And we are all ready to take the next step forward. And today Pan is going to look for some resources. Now Pan's mom's taken him to his village, you know, and Pan needs to count. So Pan doesn't have beads. Pan doesn't know what to do. So he looks at his mom and says, but I have to do my counting activity today. So what should I do? So Pan's mom goes down to the fields and she sees this bamboo and she asks someone to cut it. And then she brings these rings for Pan. And she pulls out a shoelace and says, hey, Pan, I can help you to count. Come on, let's learn. So Pan becomes really happy, picks up his shoelace, fixes it at the end and says, okay, I am going to learn how to count today and I'm going to use bamboo for it. So Pan is also learning. So he just takes an old strip of paper and takes a shoelace and counts. Happily, Pan is counting with the help of bamboo rings. And he learns how to use both his hands, counts very beautifully. 1, 2, 3, 4. And Mama says that you have to stop when you reach 10. So he has 4 now, and then 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. And he has a beautiful string of bamboo rings, right? So he realizes that, oh my God, I can learn how to count with anything. I can use stones, I can use bamboo rings, I can use sticks, I can use leaves, and there's just so much and so easily I can do this. Now Pan comes back and then goes back the next holiday. And now Pan already knows 1 to 10. And this time, ma'am has also asked Pan to learn how to count bigger numbers. So 10 and one more. And you know what he picks up? He picks up the bamboo and learns how to count 10 and one more, 10 and two more. And he is sorted. Then after that, the next holiday, he goes back and he has to learn how to do addition. So goes back, picks up the rings and actually learns how to do addition. So now Pan is very happy. He realizes that he can use the same resources to learn so many things. And I think that's what is about managing resources and setting up activity-based learning centers. You know, the first thought that comes to our head when we say activity-based learning centers or activity-based learning classrooms. The first thought is it going to be expensive? How easy is it going to be for us to build all of this? Can we afford it or not? So the last few weeks, we've been discussing a couple of topics which are going to help us lead up to setting up our activity centers. So the one thing that I've noticed in the last many, many years of my travel and my interaction with schools is that everybody just orders a lot of resources without really analyzing what the need is. You know, do we need this? Do we need this? Can this be reused? Can we do it in a simpler way? So without that, if you just order resources and resources and then logging of resources, how many times have you used that particular resource? In how many ways have you used that resource? All that is extremely important for us to set up good activity centers. So step one is to know your domains, which we talked about a couple of weeks back. So the social emotional domain, the language, the numeracy, the EVS, the scientific temperament, the art, the problem solving, So these are the domains of development of the children. Second step is to see the developmental continuum. At which stage would a child need what? So once you know the domains, once you have looked at the basic, this is what is required for a 3-year-old, 4-year-old and 5-year-old, how many resources can be upgraded and used in different ways? Then when you make your resource centers, one, you will be able to keep them within a sensible budget. Secondly, you will be able to reuse and recycle a lot of resources. So I think that is why perhaps I did not start with setting up of activity centers, because we went step by step. Unless I know my domains, unless I know what I need at each level, what are my list of activities that I need, I probably may not be able to build a sensible learning center. Now, learning centers can have the simplest of things. Now, suppose we're doing social emotional development. You know, the other day I was reading availability of really expensive journals to teach children concepts of kindness or sharing or, patience. I really don't feel you need a journal for this. You actually should have children in real life situations. That's how they will learn better. Right, we talk about resilience. How will you teach resilience unless you're going through that phase of whatever you're going through, right? So it's important to understand that when we are setting up activity-based learning centers, what all do we need? We need some really practical stationery. That's important because it'll help you to create your resources as well. You also see all around me the kind of resources I use. Also, in my profile, you'll always see a developer of KinoLearn and KinoPhonics. Now, KinoLearn is kinesthetic movement. It means children will learn, explore, and move. Move, explore, and learn. Now, to do all of that, you need the simplest of things. So, make your list. The first thing I would do is get my domains ready. Get what I need for the development of each domain. And how would I set up not only activity centers in my environment and school, but how I would set up activity centers in my classroom? Because that is really, really important, right? Otherwise, you have to. And in today's circumstances, getting the parents to set up the activity centers at home, I think it's all of it, which now that will also have to be considered, right? So we had done that. How will you put up little art center? How will you put up a reading center? How will you put up? So activity-based learning, when I started working with it, I would just collect every resource and consolidate it, put it in lists, and I would start a center. And each time people said, oh my God, it's so easy to do. Yes, it is. It's actually that easy to do. For example, if you want the physical development of the child, then just getting very simple things, even something like drawing a line and making them walk, letting them play outside, crushing paper and throwing and catching, stacking of boxes, even a water bottle, opening and closing the lid. All this contributes to activity centers, and we keep imagining it to be this ideal, perfect activity center. I have always worked with low-cost resources, always. Even if I worked in the most expensive schools, I always said, why don't we just uncomplicate it, And I think as the commercial markets are growing, we are making it that complicated for children. So you can use as simple as this. There's a lovely program that has been started by the government, and they've said, toys in learning. So how many times are we really using toys in learning? And another thing very important in the Indian scenario is we have a lot of very traditional toys, So if we can use that, one, it'll bring our traditional artists back into circulation. And secondly, it will expose our children to some part of our cultural heritage. So when you are doing activity-based learning, it's and setting up centers, it's very, very important to understand that we need to first get our thoughts into place. We need to very clearly put our, spaces into place. So today, I will use my notes to talk to all of you. Normally, I, can do it on the screen, but last few days has been a very COVID active time for everybody. Homes have been, everybody's kind of been stuck with a lot of health issues. So yeah, sometimes you just have to rely on your basic skills to take things forward. So that's what I'm going to do today. So what is a learning center, first of all? First to get it into our heads, what is a learning center? A learning center is a space which an adult can organize for a child to explore and learn. That's a learning center. That's an activity-based center where the child can explore and learn. A very important part of the activity-based learning is about creating a space for self-exploration. But imagine, not only is it self-exploration, but also self-discipline. Because if you have 30, 35 children in a classroom and they are not disciplined, any amount of resources get wasted. So the first ground rule of any activity-based environment is to have a place for everything and put everything back in the place. That is rule number one. A place for everything, everything back in the place. The teacher has to do it, the children have to do it, and that's how it works. The second most important thing is logging of every resource that has been got into the activity space. It could be an eraser, it could be beads. And you have to believe me that these rings of bamboo are at least maybe about 15 years old. And I have 50, I think I have 40 of them. I have it in 4 colors. And this actually was done in a village. And the color coding is done with the electricity tape, because those only 4 colors are available in the electricity tape: red, blue, black, and green. And imagine somebody in some little village did this for me. She said that, PVC pipes. So don't underestimate any resource. Just remember that these resources can be put together in multiple different ways. Like, for example, a resource like this can be used for counting, for doing the tens and ones, for doing the addition, for doing the subtraction, and even the multiplication, and even the string of 50. So let's not underestimate any resource at all. I'll give you another one or two examples just as I go on how resources can be used and not underestimated at all, right? So I'm going to just very quickly, today I will need more sips of my tea, because I think the throat is giving me enough, a story of. All right. I'm going to also show you resources from the heart of India. Then we talked about resources, how such beautiful resources have been built. So I was traveling, and this is something which somebody had introduced to me many, many years back. This is a paper packet, a normal paper packet, which you call pack, the from a village. And this teacher first used this to teach them the swar. So, ullu, urta aya, uske saar, ek oont aya, oont aya, ullu, oont, or hir. She distributed the letters, जैसे अक्षर distribute कर दिए, और सुबह से लेके शाम तक उल्लू रात को जागता और उप 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 करता, ऊंट घूमता रहता, उसकी टांगे बहुत दुखती तो वो ऊ करता। अब जब उल्लू बैठता तो जो भी अक्षर होता उसमें उप लग जाता, तो अगर है तो, और अगर क है तो कू। तो उसने बस ये 2 पैकेट्स के साथ बच्चों को अक्षर डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करके कभी किसी के कांधे पे उप बैठ जाता, कभी ऊ बैठ जाता, और उसने मात्राएं सिखा दी। क्या था ये रिसोर्स? इट्स जस्ट अ पेपर पैकेट. So when you create your resources, when you collect, and each of these resources of mine are from the time that I was a teacher, and that is good 15 years back. They are laminated, they can be reused, and children can manage them beautifully. So think of resources as simple as this. As simple as this. Itni saadgi ke saath resources banaiye and use things which you perhaps don't think that you'll be able to use. Think about it, you know. So this is like that little creative thinking thought process. So you need to set up for language, you need to set up for math, you need to set up for art, you need to set up for problem solving, you need to set up for story time, you need to set up theme boards. It's a lot to set up, but can be done with such simple, low-cost resources. And that's what I want to talk about today. That you can actually create budgets and work within very, very limited budgets for creating this whole process of. So when you do language, a lot of flashcards, very easy, very inexpensive, a lot of stick puppets, a lot of pockets. And your words, your letters, your Hindi Varnmala, and whatever you're using as pockets, see to it that multiple usage happens. You should be able to do the word building in it. You should put the letters in it. You should be able to do the sounds and symbols in it. You should be able to build the words in it. So very simple, straightforward resources. Now you want textured letters. It's so simple. Just take a printout of the outline, you know, the hollow letters. And paste it onto, or just place it on the sandpaper and just draw it and cut it out. It's a matter of 20, 25 minutes for every 5 letters. And after every week, you just build 5 letters for the children. It works. Can they use it for the whole year? Yes. Because these are resources which are so easy to use, very, very easy to use. Then establishing a community that takes care of these resources. So first of all, getting your resources in place, establishing a community that takes care of these resources, logging resources, putting up the resources in a place where every teacher finds it accessible, and every activity center to have a slightly different set of resources so it can be cycled. With that, the advantage is variety. It is that every teacher will have access to other teachers' resources, and the children will have access to different kinds of resources. So I think that's one thing which I've always asked teachers to build and say that, oh my God, this is that easy to do. If we just go through very quickly what all we could, you know, keep in these resource centers, something as in an art center, just some glue, old paper, crayons, a little bit of paint. And a creative center would also have a small little stool, you know. You could just, in India, you have those small PDs, those small stools, which could actually become the stand-up stage for a child. So that little art center can have something as little as this. If you have small classrooms, you can circulate your centers. This week, the activity center could be the art center. Mm-hmm. Next week, the activity center could be the reading center. The week after that, it could be the math center. And this is how your whole cycle can circulate. Like, for example, if you have A section, B section, C section, and D section, of course, in these circumstances, with everything online, it's different. But children are going to come back to school and we are going to get them all back, hopefully, as soon as possible. So, the art center in A section goes to B section and then B to C and C to D, and the whole cycle rotates. So you know, if you have big classrooms, wonderful. God bless you. If you don't, still small activity centers can be put up very, very, very easily. So I think that's what everybody has to look at. Making lists. So today the printout says, make your list of stationery, make your list of material, make your list of maths material, language material, Hindi material. And at the end of the year, you must tally it. You know, each time I have set up centers in schools, after I go back after a few years, I realize that the material is not there. And when you ask them, they'll say, you know, we don't really know. Yeah, it was there somewhere. So instead of growing our resources, we reduce them. Digital is great. It's a great tool, but children need the movement of both their hands. Children need to smell, touch, taste, move around. So these are parts of the development of the child, which are so necessary. So activity centers, besides being, you know, just digital centers, you can't just have this digital learning for children. It doesn't work like that. And what is so interesting is that the government is actually asking for entries for understanding how much of curriculum has been done through toys, games. And today they're talking about it and saying that please make this happen, you know. So the eye-hand coordination has to be taken care of. Both the hands has to be taken care of. Muscles have to be developed. So that will happen only with activities. It can't happen on digital because everything is about keeping a hand flat on the digital, just the finger space. Okay, it's not that the digital is bad, but for little children, activity centers must be set up. It's very, very important for the children to do that. Also, why activity centers and the growth of the activity centers is that it creates a kind of a responsibility. It creates an ability to share. It creates an ability to be patient, to make things work for children who are not able to get it, because peer learning is at its best in the activity centers, where the adult is just facilitating and watching children. You should see children walking up to the others and saying, "Main kar deta hu, main sikha deta hu, I will teach you." And that little child responds so beautifully to their own peer group. So activity-based learning centers will create all of this. Another thing very important that activity-based center and resources, like I said, resources, anything even as small as if like this week, all the parents send a clean handkerchief, right? The folding of a handkerchief is a resource. You fold it into half, then you fold it one more, you fold it into a triangle, you can make little designs with it. You can roll it up. You can make, imagine a thing like a handkerchief. Even that becomes a resource. We need to imagine resources besides all the ready-made ones that we buy. That if I need to do a folding activity, I can just use hankies. If I want to do a buttoning activity, I can just ask for 3-4 shirts, put them up on a hanger, and hang them up in my classroom. If I want to do threading, I can do old PVC pipes or, rings like this. If I want to do stories, I can just do, a kind of a stool and children to be on there for expression and storytelling and narration. I don't need a big stage and a mic and it's required. So start looking at resources in the way that it is affordable, recyclable, and how can you take it to the next level of complexity? I think that's what we need to look at for resources, you know. Like dominoes or like a puzzle, you know. So suppose I take a sheet of paper. I'll actually do this for you, you know, 1 minute. I'll just get it and do it for you. So we are talking about creating resources, the simplest of resources. So I want to create these 2-piece puzzles for children, right? So I can actually just maybe draw, I'll do the simplest one. Maybe I'll just draw a flower, okay? I'll tell the children to color it. And after that, I will just cut it into 2 pieces or 4 pieces and then ask the children to join it up again. So as simple as this, right? I cut it into two. And I put multiple of these. Like I can put some flowers, some rabbits, some butterflies, whatever. And then after a few days, the children, the same children are using this resource. And I cut it into four. And they have to arrange these four pieces. What did it cost me? Nothing. And imagine the range of resources I can make. Sequencing cards, when you do storytelling, you know, we make it so complex. We want ready-made material. All it does is just take little cards and sequence a story and give it to the children. Just line drawing will do. You know, so imagine the simplest of resources, but taking care of them. I think that is the most important part about activity-based learning, to get every kind of resource into your activities. Also because it's a generation of plenty. So these children don't learn how to take care of it. So it's very, very important to create a classroom community that takes care, to have centers with very minimal resources. Look at the interest areas of the children. That's another very important thing, that, you know, through the year, the interests will change. You could actually do a little science center one day. You could do up an art center one day. You could do a story center, book center. You could take a normal cushion and dupattas and make a little reading cushion. You can put maybe four cushions there and say this is your reading corner. When you finish, you can go there and sit down and read. So imagine resources beyond what you buy. I think that is one very, very important thing about setting up activity-based centers. Setting up fantastic activity rooms, perfect, absolutely picture perfect, is not possible for everybody. The finances don't permit. Sometimes the, you know, the there is not that kind of a financial support. So look at activity-based learning centers as material which you can bring on a very, very low cost. And India fortunately has, so you need resources, you need stuff to store the resources, you need it to be recycled and, you know, made into more challenging activities. You need a responsible set of children who will take care of them, a place for everything and everything back in its place. So I think this just helps us. Even dominoes, you know, we have these really expensive domino cards. And we used to just make dominoes out of old visiting cards. And it worked so beautifully. You know, now you don't use matchboxes anymore. But even these boxes used to be such wonderful thing. We used to clean off the you know, powder on the sides and used to make these boxes which you could actually fit in. There was this lovely, you know, once I had come across a lovely book that said low-cost resources. And it was amazing the kind of things that people were making. And it was, so these are a lot of whatever I use in my resource centers. So these resource centers don't look picture perfect. They don't look like a wow, you know, but they take care of the basic needs of the children. And you'll be surprised how much of imagination they bring about, because if you have boxes, if you have things they can stack up, they will just imagine, they will do things on their own, and they'll make it really, really interesting and beautiful. So if you can, when you're setting up an activity center for your classrooms, all right, think of the most important domains that you have to touch that week, that month. Think of resources which are available in the environment. Pick those up first. If you don't have and they don't fall into the category, then you can outsource and buy them. And most importantly, recycle your resources and share them with different teachers. So if you're making resources for four stories, let a teacher make it for another four. So another four, another four. So you have 16, 20 stories sorted out for the whole year. When you have math material, when you have material for counting, you can use rings, somebody else can use bamboo sticks, third person can use maybe PVC pipes from maybe this, if they're a village center. And some people can use beads and then cycle it. so that newness comes in and your resources get used. It's also very important for children to learn how to reuse material again and again. So today, everything is so much in plenty that children get bored very fast. So that's another thing which, you know, after some time, you can fill your school with things, but the children still are looking for something else to do. So a certain amount of revisiting with variety is a great requirement. A lot of Play-Doh, a lot of punch machines, a lot of paints, a lot of imagination. Just allow all that to be a part of, like when we say art integrated learning. So for English, suppose your children are doing a story. Can their art be a part of it? Yes. Suppose they're doing shapes. Can we make the art center a part of it? So don't isolate things. So if you're doing one concept, also see to it that other things become a part of this concept. So I think if you take care of all of this, it will definitely help us to build better activity centers. Ideally, an activity center for me would have magnifying glass, it would have magnets, it would have containers to pour water, it would have feely boxes. You know, feely boxes can be made with any resource you have. You can just put a lot of things and the child can put in and do that. Then they would have a lot of sensory activity things where I can put textures and I can put smooth things, rough things, very rough things. It could be even fabric that can be used. Then I would want to have, some nice racks, maybe one or two good racks so that my things can be stored in. I would want to have musical instruments 100% in my activity center, little dholak, little dambu, little tambourine, so that the children can actually have, a little movement. I would want a lot of puzzles, that's for sure. 5-piece puzzle, 10-piece puzzles, almost up to 25, 30-piece puzzles are lovely for children of the early years. Children, if they're building regularly, they get. Another thing very important is the balancing beams, the bean bags. What is there? When children are born in India, you just put rye, mustard, and you make bean bags for children. We stop using these resources in our country. So use them, get back certain amount of, small things like ropes, jumping ropes, balloons for just blowing and experimenting with air, very, very simple things. We have these beautiful kitchen sets and now everything is plastic. So go and explore for kitchen sets into the markets of your cities and bring in the traditional kitchen sets for the children and leave them for them. It's these are lovely things for children to explore. Even a small thing like a small carton which is becomes like a bed, and where you can fold the things, where you can put the pillow. You can teach children how to take care of their own bed. Little things like that. Even small things like the ice cream spoons, we used to make these little slippers and we used to tell them all match them. After the matching was over, we would tell them that now you have to arrange all your slippers or your shoes like this outside the activity room whenever we used to take them there. So there are loads of things to do. Just keep looking and imagining that this all can be done. Small things like sponges, shovels, a small thing like a broom and a dustpan, dusters, napkins, all this is a part of your resource center. It is not just for maths and English. It's for a whole lot of development. It could be just a few toys, a few even a small thing like a small bucket to wash the children, for them to wash their hankies. Just imagine the activity centers to be a little simpler with resources which you may, which are not always bought and put together. large boxes of magical things for the children, you know, collect these little hats and umbrellas and, you know, a lot of things like that. And allow that to be that imagination box. Like I said, rotate your activity space in your classroom. Even if you put a carton there, which has got like a dupatta, one, you know, cap, one umbrella, one, you know, something from the house. Even that the children will imagine and make. You don't see all that happening anymore. You know, when we started, I started with activity-based learning. It was 31 years back. 31 years back is a long time. And that time, so much was not available. Yet, we would teach children textures. We would teach them fragrances. We would teach them, you know, how to take care of things. We would do the exercises of practical life. We would put up little posters for the children. We would have trains for the children. We would cut and make puzzles. So all this resource and the skills of the hand must be brought back. Because when you also come back to school, for all the schools that are very blessed with really good resources, good for you. But if you don't have the kind of resources and the finances, we should be able to create activities. What is it? Some activity for a feeling, that feeling box can be done. Some activities for sharing, you can do puzzles. Some activities for counting, some for math, some for putting tens and ones together. I do tens and ones out of simple, you know, card sheets. I just take card sheets, I cut them and I tell, give them rubber bands and say, make bundles of 10. That's it. And it works. Finally, the child has to make a bundle of 10. Now the child makes it out of ice cream sticks, card sheets. It doesn't really matter. I would just do it. Only thing is, if you can make your domains properly, list out what all needs to be done, buy whatever you need to, recycle, have some bowls, have some baskets, have some boxes, create your lists, recycle a lot of material, use the same material as the next set of learning, and things will be so much easier for all of us, because activity-based learning now has to become a reality in our classrooms. It cannot be manicured in the most perfect way, because we may not be able to have the finances for all of that. Use sticks, use puppets, use daily resources, use stones, use, you know, like I gave you very simple examples. Start thinking out of the box and then create your activity centers. I think it will, one, they become more valuable, you know, because they're valuable because you're creating out of your own resources. You're not buying it. You're actually creating it. That the value becomes much more. And the children will start learning how to use many different kind of things for different ways. Like, for example, when you see this board at the back. I use it for so many kinds of activities. I do it when I have to do a story mapping. I do it when I have to put the domains. I do it when I have to explain concepts to teams. And it's not boring. I mean, it's perfectly all right. So please do that. Display material. Think of different ways to do it. Material for language. What all can you put together? Material for numeracy. Material for scientific temperament. Art. Environment, cleaning, activities of practical life, oh, the list is huge. So make your domain list, make your list of activities, make what list of activities you're going to need for 3-year-old, 4-year-old, and 5-year-old, and now 6 and 7 also, because class 1 and 2 is also going to be included, right? And what kind of cycling of our activity centers can we do in our classrooms? And take it from there. And if you can send us some photographs of some things that you're doing or putting up, it would be a real, you know, it would be really nice. Next week, what we are going to do is, today we talked about setting up of our activity centers. Next week, I'm going to talk about the kind of activities and the kind of interaction we can do online in this present circumstances, and classroom interaction, how we can do group working, how to organize pair working, how to organize circle time. And in today's circumstances, how we can get the children to move and learn with us from the, you know, the digital space that we are in. So we'll see you next week. please don't forget to download your activity list, which is put up by the Square Panda team, and fill it up. And don't forget to have the signature, which is there for you. Build it up, enjoy it, straw, thread, sketch pen, yeah, anything. Only thing is, I would just say, don't use too much of plastic, if possible, if that is avoidable. And try and recycle everything that you have, everything. I think our activity centers will be so much alive. And thank you so much. And I hope today we've had a useful day. And I'm going to make my list of notes of all the things I had forgotten. In fact, when I was talking to you, I suddenly realized that, oh my God, there were so many things which I used to use, which I've forgotten. So let's all get our list together. Let's consolidate and let's reuse, recycle, and not waste anything at all. Thank you so much, and see you next week, next Thursday. And next week we'll be with activities and the settings. Thank you.
Square, square, panda.